is our theme this whole month, talking about our engagement as a Christian.
This is the place where I, many years ago, discovered my purpose, began to serve in ministry.
The dream of advancing Jesus' mission through church planting around the world.
Okay, let's turn to the word for today and the things that God has laid on my heart to share with you as we begin this new series of reflections. This month, a heavy topic on persecution and the price that some of our brothers and sisters around the world are paying for their faith. We've just come from India, and we met with pastors who shared their stories of suffering with us. Some of them have been beaten, others have lost loved ones, members of their own family, as they were persecuted for their faith. And persecution, especially of Christians around the world, is going on. It's on the increase, not on the decrease. And we need to remember those who are living in persecution and pray for them. This was the one thing that they kept asking for. Please tell our brothers and sisters in Kenya to pray for us. And so we will. But let's begin by watching a short video that puts it in context for us.
Christians are paying a huge price because of their loyalty to Jesus Christ and their love for Him. They may be abandoned by others, but not by God.
My father in this world left me, but my father in heaven will never leave me.
I love my parents so much. I want them to know that I'm praying that the Lord will open their hearts and minds.
I would like to send a message to my dad. You say you want to kill me, to shed my blood in public. No matter what decision you make, I forgive you.
There are two ways when the government finds out someone is a Christian. There is execution. And number two, when a Christian gives up their religion, they are sent to the countryside to political concentration camps.
If they found me praying or encouraging my friends in Christ, they would take me and put me in prison. They try to force us to deny our faith and beat us when we refuse.
The mob threatened us, saying that India belongs to Hindus. Christians do not belong here.
They make slogan, Christians have to move from this village, otherwise we will kill.
They warned us that if we rebuilt the churches, they would kill us. They would break our body into pieces, just like they broke our church into pieces.
Many have come to me and said that they went to a church and were told not to come. That makes my heart sad.
I can't see how we are second-class believers. Just because some inherited their faith from their parents and others searched for God and found Him.
Many Christians have abandoned us. They could have helped us, but they didn't. These people are supposed to stand with us and have a part in solving our problems.
First, the Christians were pushing us to go to the church and be at the meetings. But after I went to jail, they said, please don't come to the church again to avoid us having problems.
We are asking the Lord to give us more boldness, to give us the strength to bear His name and to stand strong in the face of terrible persecution.
They cannot burn Christ and the church from our hearts. We are in God's hands.
I have the Holy Spirit inside me, and He gives me the strength not to be afraid.
It was really hard, but praise God, God took every care. No one backslide, no one left Christ. They became very strong believers.
My faith was never shaken. I know that in all situations, God is with me.
Whenever the persecution comes in your life, do not be discouraged. Just go and ask strength from God, and God will save you. God will guide you in every difficulty. In every difficult situation, keep strong faith in God.
I will always trust God who gives me another new life. Always God with me everywhere.
God has strengthened me. He has made me bold. I cannot stop. I must continue this because I was chosen by God for this work.
We want people around the world to pray for us. We want people to speak out on our behalf so that we can have the freedom to practice our faith.
It is estimated that about 300 Christians are killed every month somewhere around the world, and that about 200 churches are burned each month. Hundreds and thousands of Christians face persecution in milder forms, apart from being killed, being denied access to the village well in India, which then means that you don't have access to good or clean water, being ostracized from the community and forced to leave your village and your family, being ridiculed and abused, being denied jobs, imprisonment, public floggings, divorce for women who convert to Christ, and many other forms of persecution, short of being killed for their faith. And as I said, Christian persecution is on the increase worldwide. 42 countries top the list as countries that outrightly persecute Christians. North Korea, probably the most repressive country when it comes to Christianity and indeed any faith. There is only one person that is to be worshipped in North Korea, and that is the premier. Any religion, any expression of worship towards anyone else is persecuted and forbidden. Indonesia, the largest Muslim country in the world, Christians are persecuted there. Bhutan and Iran, they mercilessly persecute Christians in those countries. But that's not the only place. Persecution around the world is rated on a scale of 1 to 7. These four countries, North Korea, Indonesia, Bhutan, and Iran, list as a 7 out of 7 because of the severity of the persecution that Christians are facing. But there are many other countries that list as a 6 or a 5 or a 4. Burma, Bangladesh, India, Somalia, Vietnam, Yemen, Sudan, Saudi Arabia, China, North Nigeria, Afghanistan, Pakistan, Syria, and Eritrea are all on that list. But you know, my brothers and sisters, we should not be surprised at persecution, because Jesus told us in the book of John chapter 15 and verse 20, remember what I told you, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you also. If they obeyed my teaching, they will obey you also. And suffering for our faith is to be expected. Jesus suffered. The early church disciples suffered. Paul suffered and was persecuted. The early Christians, post the book of Acts, post the Bible days that are recorded for us, were mercilessly persecuted by the Roman Empire. One particular emperor, called Nero, would light up Christians in his garden, alive to light up his garden at night. America was first populated by Christians, the Puritans and the Anabaptists, who were fleeing the persecution they faced in Europe. These were people who had accepted Christ as their Lord and Savior. And because Europe was Catholic and Anglican, they were not welcome. They were seen to be apostates who had given up on the true faith, and they were persecuted mercilessly, and they ran away to new lands to find a new place to live. Here in Kenya, the first African converts, your grandparents or your great-grandparents, were persecuted for their faith. My father, my grandfather on my mother's side, was the first Christian in his village. and he suffered for it. During the Mau Mau uprising, Christians were persecuted because they were seen to have capitulated to the religion of the white man and therefore were seen to be collaborators with the white man. They were not trusted by the local communities, and the white man himself did not trust them either. And so they were cast out of their communities and in that sense persecuted by the Mau Mau and by the colonial government. Whenever the gospel of light encounters darkness, there is a spiritual battle for the souls of men. And the battle is in the spiritual realm. We have an enemy. And he's determined in whatever way, with whatever means, to quench your faith and to lead you astray. And if pain and threat of death and persecution will make you abandon Christ, then he will use even that too. We're in a battle, and the Bible talks about warfare, spiritual warfare for the souls of men and women. I shared a story here some time back, so some of you may be familiar with this. Maybe you're visiting and you haven't heard this. Of a church in China where during the service, some gunmen walked in with AK-47s and they came up to the front of the church and they told the gathered church, if you're here today and you're a Christian, stand up and move to the side. The rest of you leave. And the bulk of the church left. Only a few were left in the church. And so these gunmen went and they closed the doors at the back, came back to the front and said, you are the true believers. Now let's worship God. I wonder if that happened here, how many of you would be here? Pastor Nick, would you be here? There are many who face that question on a daily basis concerning their faith. My wife and I went to India to meet the leader of a ministry there called the Central India Christian Mission. It's led by a gentleman and his wife called Dr. Ajay and Mrs. Indu Lal. They started a ministry 35 years ago as a young couple. And in his young years, Ajay Lal prayed that God would send him with a difficult commission. He did not want to go to a place where the church already exists, where there are already Christians. He was praying that God would use his life to go to the difficult places where the gospel has been rejected. That was where he wanted to preach the good news of Christ. His prayer, his personal prayer, was that God would send him to Afghanistan. But God didn't send him there. God sent him to North India. And over the last 35 years, he and the people he works with and has trained have planted a total of 1,700 churches in North India. Let me tell you about India. India is a Hindu country by and large. 80% of the population is Hindu. And then they're Muslims. And then they're Buddhists. And only about 1.5% are Christians. North India, I'll put up a map on the screen. The yellow part that you see on the screen, North India is the most unreached place in the world by the gospel of Jesus Christ. There are more people in North India who have never heard the name of Jesus Christ. They do not know who he is. They do not know the gospel. They have never had anyone preach a message of salvation to them. And there are largely no churches accessible to millions upon millions upon millions of people in North India. This is where largely the Hindus are. The South India, the orange part, there are big pockets of Christians in that. And this is where most mission efforts in the last 300 years have been, in South India. And so states like Kerala state has about 79% Christian. But North India is the most unreached place in the world today. The green parts that you find are places where there are pockets of Buddhists and pockets of Christians. But the yellow part is Hindu territory. And it's an unreached territory. And this is where God sent R.J. Lal and his wife to a state called Madhya Pradesh that borders some of the states that have the worst persecution in North India. When I spoke to the church and I had a chance to speak to some church planters, let me show you a couple of photos. This is a church gathered in worship, though that's a worship team up on stage, and these are who were present during the service itself. It's a large community. And then a picture of the church planters who are training to go out. And they know that as they train to go out and be pastors and to start new churches in rural India, that they will face persecution. And they're prepared for it. I had the opportunity to address them and to speak to them. And then R.J. Lal invited some of his already existent pastors to come and sit with us for a morning and share their stories with us. We had about 8 pastors come, and they shared their story of suffering. And I tell you, my dear friends, they wept as they spoke about the suffering they've gone through. And we were completely astounded by their stories. Let me tell you the story of Pastor Sarat. Sarat grew up in a high-caste Hindu family, and his father was like a king or a ruler in the part that they came from. He oversaw, I think, about 80 villages that made up a population of about 500,000 people, and he was the leader of that community. And so he took his son and sent him to school in the city, about 80 kilometers away, because he wanted this boy to learn well, prepare, understand leadership, come back and take over the leadership of this community of people. So Sarat went to boarding school at the age of about 10 years. By the time he was 14, he was in the wrong company. He was drinking. He had become addicted to alcohol. He was living a licentious life as a 14-year-old boy, and he was already doing drugs at 14 years. His father did not know. His father believed that he was studying, preparing. But one day, Sarat and his friends, his little group of friends, got into the drug trade and started distributing drugs, making money off that, and then living the high life. One day, they were caught by the police, because the police got to know about them. They were caught by the police with 50 kilograms of marijuana, and they were put in prison. Well, his father came and bailed him out and took him back to the village, gathered as many of that community as he could, hundreds of people, and in front of them, he clearly said to the community, "This boy has shamed our family. He is no longer a member of our family. We dispossess him and disinherit him. He is forbidden to come back to this home, and he is not allowed in this community anymore. He is no longer my son." And they kicked him out at the mere age of about 15 years. Sarat went back to the city. It was the only place he knew. And he went back to the community, the group of people that they had been doing drugs with. And his life tanked. He became completely addicted to drugs, finding solace in them because there was no other place for him to go. But he could see that his life had spun out of control. It was getting worse and worse, and he decided to kill himself. And so he went and bought poison, went outside the city limits, sat down, and was ready to drink the poison. When an old man came across him and told him, "Don't take the poison, don't drink, don't take your life." This man was a pastor with the CICM, the Central India Christian Mission. And he told him about the Lord Jesus Christ and how God had died for him because he loved and cared for him. Sarat, of course, was captivated by this story. He had never heard it, but to think that when everyone else had abandoned him, there was one person who still cared for him. He did not take his life. It so happened that 3 days later, Dr. R.J. Lal was coming into that city to preach the gospel. And so Sarat went for that meeting. He was not yet a Christian, had not yet accepted Christ, but he was curious. And because he was told about that meeting, he went along. R.J. was speaking that evening on the prodigal son, who took his wealth, went far away, lived a licentious life, and when he was in the pigsty, he remembered his father and covenanted to go back. And Sarah told my wife and I that as he heard this story, he knew that this was God speaking to him because this was his life. And that there is a Father in heaven who would still receive him even though his life was in such ruin. And so that night, he accepted Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. Because he had nowhere to go, he only knew the city and his old gang. He went up to R.J. Lal and said, "Please help me because I don't know what to do with myself now." R.J. took him into his home and cared for him for the next 6 months, nursed him back to health, got him off the drugs, taught him the Bible. At the end of 6 months, Sarat said, "I want to spend the rest of my life telling people about Jesus Christ." And so R.J. sent him to Bible school where he studied for 2 years. When he finished his Bible school, the first thing he did was go back to his village. He was not allowed to stay in the village. His father did not want to see him and he never got audience. But he went to some of the young men who had already begun doing drugs that he used to do drugs with in the city. And he told them about the Lord Jesus Christ. And one young man, after about a week of persuasion, came to the place where he abandoned his drugs and he gave his life to Jesus Christ. Sarat was amazed that God could use him in this way. And he covenanted that this is what you'd do for the rest of his life. And he would preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. So he started going around the villages in that community, telling them about the Lord Jesus Christ. About 35 families accepted Christ. And they began to gather together and to worship Jesus. Now, here's what you've got to understand about Hinduism. Hinduism as a religion has 330 million gods. And the reason is because at the very core of Hinduism is the belief that we are all gods. We are all gods. We're an embodiment of their primary deity who is called Shiva, the auspicious one. This is what Shiva looks like. And Shiva has entered, you know, into the sphere of humanity in many different forms. And therefore, everybody is a god in one form or another. Now, in this sense then, the Hindus do have Jesus Christ as one of their gods. And you can worship Jesus Christ as a Hindu because you're allowed to choose the god you want to worship. And the thing they do is, I spoke with two young men who were training for the pastorate, and they told me that in Hinduism, you get to choose a god that you want to worship. You can't worship all 330 million. And so you choose the one that works for you. And you may say, "I like this god because when I pray to him, my prayers are answered." But your brother may say, "I like that one instead because he seems to hear me and answer my prayers." You're welcome to choose a god you want to worship. And so Jesus Christ is one of them, and you can worship. But the difference with Christianity is this, that Christianity, you come to the place where you say, having converted, having received Christ as my Lord and Savior, I believe what Jesus said in John chapter 14 and verse 6. "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." In other words, that's an exclusive statement. There is no other God than Jesus Christ. And this is why we as Christians do not say that all roads lead to heaven. They don't. Only one road leads to heaven. And it's not me making that decision. It is Jesus Christ himself who teaches us. No one comes to the Father except through me. When you do that and you convert to Christianity, in essence, you're saying all the 330 million gods do not amount to anything. And Shiva is not God. And the thing that clearly makes a statement within Hindu communities is this. When you go through the waters of baptism, you are declaring that you have abandoned all others and you have only one as your Lord and your Savior. At that point, persecution begins, because then the Hindus will not accept that you have dismissed all their gods and declare that only the Christian God is God. Sarat became a pastor, traveling all over North India, preaching Christ. And the extremist Hindus got wind of this. And so they came to his home to threaten and to kill him. In 2004, they came to his home. He managed to escape. His wife managed to escape with him. Three of their boys managed to escape. But their young daughter, 15 years old, could not get away fast enough. And so the extremist Hindus took her and they raped her as a punishment towards him. As Sarat told us this, there were tears in his eyes talking about his daughter. Today he has baptized over 6,000 Christians in that part of India and planted 14 churches. And his three sons, have become pastors alongside him. His father and mother eventually came to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior because they were amazed at the transformation that had taken place in this young man's life. But when they accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, their brothers came and took them, dethroned his father, shamed them in public, beat them up, and excommunicated them from the community. His father and mother now live with him because they cannot go back to their village. His daughter, who was raped, was destined never to get married because in India, it is taboo to marry what they consider a defiled girl. And you know, in India, many of their marriages are not love marriages. They're arranged marriages where you look for a wife for your son and you try and match a suitable wife. Who would want to marry a girl who has been raped? But by God's grace, there was a Christian family who was interested, and Sarat and his wife covenanted that they would not hide what had happened to their daughter. And so they told the parents of this young man and the young man himself that she had been raped. Are you sure that you want to continue with the matchmaking and the negotiations? And this Christian family said that they consider the suffering and the persecution she had gone through to be a sign of her faith, and they would continue with the negotiations. Today she's married to a Christian man and they have three sons. As we heard these stories, thank you. As we heard these stories, we were undone. What do you say to this sort of faith? In 2008, the persecution in India hit international headlines and media. 54 pastors were killed in Orissa. 5,300 Christian homes were burned to the ground. 250 Christian church members were beaten to death or beheaded. The government did nothing to arrest the Hindu extremists. Many Christians ran off into the jungle to find shelter there, living exposed to the elements. Many children died. They lost everything. They were forbidden to drink at the village well and so had no access to clean water or to anybody's help. The extremists would pay 10,000 rupees, that's about 15,000 Kenyan shillings, for anyone who killed a pastor. And they would pay 5,000 rupees, that's about 7,500, for anyone who burnt a church to the ground. I want to share this video with you so that you can see what happened.
Well, the attacks against Christians in Orissa began on August 24th and have continued ever since. We're getting daily reports of churches being burned to the ground, Christian homes being destroyed, as well as daily reports of attacks against Christian believers. But why is this happening? Why is this taking place today here in India? Well, I had a chance to visit the epicenter in Kandamal to get a closer look at the persecution of Christians. Here's my report.
They asked him, "Will you deny Christ and become a Hindu?" He said no. Then I saw the Hindu mob pour gasoline on my brother-in-law and they burnt him alive.
They surrounded the church and within minutes the whole building was on fire.
I could hear them coming towards my house and chanting, "Come out, Christians, you don't belong here. If your God is real, come out and face us."
They broke into the house and started beating me. Then they dragged me out front and pulled out a sword. Another person had an axe in his hand.
All I could do was grab my three children and run. We ran for our lives into the jungle. We spent nights hiding without food or water.
In this remote eastern region of India, Hindu radicals are accused of a deliberate and systematic campaign to eradicate Christians from the land.
Every single Christian denomination has been attacked. Our schools, our colleges, our orphanages, everything that Christians own, Christian home, Christian institution, Christian churches have been attacked.
For more than a month now, Orissa has witnessed some of the worst persecution against Christians ever in India's history. Violence began a month ago when a Hindu leader was murdered here. Hindu fanatic groups held Christians responsible for it and went on a rampage, an allegation that's been denied by Christian leaders in the area. 4,000 Christian homes and some 400 churches were destroyed. Events in Orissa triggered violence against Christians in a number of other states. At the root of the conflict, say Christian leaders, are efforts by Hindu radicals to stop lower caste Hindus, known as untouchables or Dalits, from converting to Christianity.
The Hindu mob wanted us to convert back to Hinduism. They told us that if we became Hindu and rejected Christianity, we could stay. Otherwise, they would burn our homes and we would have to leave the village.
Dalits make up one-fifth of India's 1 billion-plus population. They live on the margins of society and are often described by Hindus as less than human. Christian groups say lower caste Hindus convert willingly to escape the 3,000 years of discrimination under the caste system.
So when we talk of what is happening to Dalit, it's a freedom movement. What happens in a freedom movement? They're seeking any one way which will make them free. Christianity offers them one.
Hallelujah!
And the numbers have been especially dramatic in Orissa, where Christians now make up some 27% of the population.
The Hindu gods did nothing for me. They didn't bring me any peace. They could not answer my problems. But in Christianity, I found true peace and freedom from the Hindu caste system.
But some Hindus have accused Christians of converting Dalits against their will.
They use bribery and money to trick Dalits into becoming Christians. Conversions and Christian missionaries are a threat to India.
Prakash Sharma is one of the key leaders in Bajrang Dal, an influential extremist Hindu group that's suspected of spearheading the attacks against Christians.
My message to Christians in India is stop your conversions. The violence in Orissa is a reaction by Hindus to these conversions.
CBN News met survivors of the Orissa attacks who described Christians being forcibly converted to Hinduism under the threat of death.
We saw 14 to 15 families being forced to drink cow urine as part of the conversion ceremony. Then they had to sign a letter saying that they had become Hindus and would obey orders to attack Christians.
The violence has left more than 50,000 Christians displaced. Most of them are crammed into relief camps like this one. Thousands are said to be missing or hiding in the jungles.
And the situation for these Christians isn't getting much easier. There are reports that the Hindu radicals have made threats against them, saying that if they intend on coming back to their destroyed villages, they must renounce Christ.
We will never do that. We may have lost everything, but we will never turn our backs on Christ. I still have joy, and I'm thanking God despite my circumstances.
The Indian government is facing growing international criticism for failing to stamp out the violence. The government has deployed several hundred more police to the region. Some are also calling on the government to ban groups like the Bajrang Dal and other extremist Hindu outfits that promote violence and religious intolerance. More than a month after the attacks began, some Christians are slowly finding the courage to come out from hiding in the jungles and are walking to the nearest refugee camp, uncertain about their future, but hopeful they can one day go back home.
Please pray for us that we can go back to our destroyed homes, rebuild them, and be a stronger witness for God among the non-Christians of our village.
Hallelujah! Hallelujah!
In the meantime, thousands of Christians have been gathering in the nation's capital city, New Delhi, for a week-long of prayer rallies as well as peaceful protests. It all culminated on October 2nd, a very important day here in India, as well as a national holiday. It is the birthday of Mahatma Gandhi. And so Christians chose this very important day to send a clear message, not only to the central government in New Delhi, but also the government in Orissa, that Christians will continue to stand for human rights as well as demanding religious freedom. And the organizers of these peaceful protests say they will continue to hold these events until the persecution of Christians in Orissa comes to an end. We will continue to monitor the situation here in the weeks and months ahead. I am George Thomas for CBN News in India.
Pastor Ajay told us one particularly gripping story that had happened to one of his pastors. The extremists came to the home of this pastor and dragged him out and beat him severely, calling him to renounce Christ and to convert back to Hinduism. They brought his wife and his 8-month-year-old baby and told him that he must do it, and so must they. The pastor refused. And so they told the wife that we will kill your husband in front of you. And they used the machete to cut off his limbs one after the other and killed him. Then they told the wife to renounce her faith, and she refused. And so they took her baby, 8 months old, and they dashed his head against the wall of the house and killed him. But she still refused to renounce Christ. And so they gang raped her, and then they poured kerosene on her and set her alight. She didn't die. They walked off thinking that she would die, but she managed to crawl to a barrel of water and to douse out the fire. But by then she was so weak she could not help herself. After the extremists had gone, some Christians came to see what had happened at that home, and they found her still alive. They took her to where RJ is because they run a 150-bed hospital. He put her in there, they cared for her, and nursed her back to health. And when she was finally healthy again, when she had healed of the trauma and the pain and the loss, RJ asked her, "What do you want us to do? Do you want us to send you to a different part of India where you will not face persecution again and where you can live a quiet life?" And she said, "No, I want to go back and finish what my husband began. I want to go back to the same village and continue to share the gospel." What do you say to that sort of faith? They asked me to preach to these young pastors who are about to go out. And the pastors who had suffered were also there. What can I say to those who have seen persecution like this, those who are going into ministry knowing that they may likely pay a price for preaching the gospel? I chose to speak to them the words of Romans chapter 6, verse 3 and 4. Paul writes and he says to the church in Rome, "Do you not know that all of us who are baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. In essence, what Paul is saying is this. When you went through the waters of baptism, you were lowered into the water. And in that act of going under, you died to your old life. You were buried, not in the ground, but in this case, in water. And had you been left there, you would truly have died. But symbolically, after you had died to your old self, to your old ways, to your old desires, to your old career, to your old dreams, to your old passions, to your old habits and your old addictions, you were raised up out of the water into a new life. A life to be lived for Jesus Christ alone. Paul goes on in Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20 to say, "It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and died, gave himself up for me." In other words, what Paul is saying, in essence, honed down to the minimum, is this. Good people, any one of us who professes Christ as their Savior, has received Christ, has been taken through the waters of baptism, made a confession of faith, you are a dead man or woman. You no longer live. It is Christ who lives in you. Because you were buried and you died. And now that you have been raised up again, it is not the old person. It is the one raised up to live for Christ. And so I told those young men getting ready to go out and plant churches in North India, three lessons that we need to take away from what Paul says in Romans chapter 6. And the first lesson is, a dead man has no fear. If you are to go to the mortuary today and you are to put a gun to the head of one of the people in the, you know, coffins, or alternatively in the freezer, and threaten them and tell them, "I will shoot you," that man would not flinch. If you are to take a cane and threaten to beat him, if you are to take gasoline and threaten to burn him, he will not flinch. Why? Because he's dead. You can't kill a dead man again. He's already dead. And this, my dear brothers and sisters, is who we are. We do not fear because we are dead. What can you do to me when I have already died to self? You can persecute me, you can beat me, you can threaten me, but you cannot kill me because I died and was buried with Christ in the waters of baptism. And therefore, I have no fear. The Bible captures this well. In the book of Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 6, where the author of Hebrews writes and he says, "We say with confidence, the Lord is my helper, I will not be afraid. What can mere mortals do to me? I will not be afraid because I have died. And you can't kill me again." The second lesson that Paul would teach us from Romans chapter 6 is that a dead man looks only in one direction. You see, you don't put a man in the freezer at the morgue, at the mortuary, and you put him on his back tonight, and you come back the next morning and find he was so uncomfortable in the night that he turned on his side because it's a more comfortable position. A dead man faces only in one direction. He doesn't look back to the old life. He doesn't look sideways to the adverts and the attractions of the products that supposedly will give his life meaning. He faces only in one direction. And that direction is the direction of Christ. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1 and 2 Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run the race with perseverance. Verse 2, let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. A dead man faces only in one direction, and it is the direction of Jesus. I love the verse in Isaiah chapter 50 and verse 7 that says this: because the sovereign Lord helps me, I will not be disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like flint, like a solid rock, an immovable rock, determined to do his will. I have set my face like flint. I only look in one direction, determined to do the will of God. Here's the third lesson. A dead man has no future plans. You see, for many of us, we have so many plans about tomorrow, plans about our retirement, plans about, you know, the future, plans about what we'll do next week, plans about success, plans about our career, plans about how we will build our home, and plans about all the things that we want to do. We're so busy that we have no time for God. We don't have time for prayer. We don't have time to read the Word of God. We don't have time to go and tell people about Jesus Christ. We don't have time to go out on a mission to another place for the glory of God. We have so many plans. We have no time for God. But a dead man has no future plans. His plans are finished. There's nothing to distract him except to do the will of God. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 2. For I determined to know nothing while I was with you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. When Paul goes to Corinth, he's not going to tour the city. He's not going to see the historical sites. He has one purpose for being in Corinth: Jesus Christ and him crucified. And a dead man has no future plans except to do the plan of God. Earlier this year, we all read the incident that took place in Garissa and the terrible question that was asked of the students in the university there. When the Islamic extremists would ask them, are you a Christian? And anyone who said yes was shot on the spot. My dear friends, if that question was asked for you at the cost of life, would you deny Christ to save your life? Do you remember the words that Jesus said? That he who loves his life in this world will lose it, but the one who hates his life will gain it for eternity. How would you answer if it was you being persecuted? Is your faith a matter of convenience, or is it a living faith? Are you a dead man or a dead woman? Well, like I like to say, some of us didn't really die when we accepted Christ. We only fainted. So we look as though we're dead. But when we are persecuted and hit with a cane, we come alive and we run, because we never really died. What would you say if you had to pay for your faith? There are many brothers and sisters around the world who are paying a very high price. And the one thing they asked as we spoke with these pastors was, please tell the brothers and sisters in Kenya to pray for us. And so your prayer bulletin, your prayer shield this week is all about praying for our persecuted brothers and sisters around the world. And I want to ask you to take that home and take time this week to pray. It's just one prayer per day. But if you would take 5 or 10 minutes to remember our brothers and sisters in India and pray for them, because they need your prayers. And the amazing thing is, in the Bible, in the book of Acts, when the saints were persecuted, you never ever see them praying for the persecution to be removed. Indeed, even in the testimony we saw, the one man who talked about it did not ask that we pray that the persecution be removed. In the Bible, what you find in the book of Acts is, in the book of Acts chapter 4, verse 19, is they prayed that God would give them greater boldness to proclaim the name of Christ. That's what our brothers and sisters are asking for. Pray for us that we will not turn away from Christ, but that we will be even bolder than the persecution and share the good news of Jesus Christ. Let me ask us to stand to our feet. You're going to have the opportunity to pray through the course of the week, but for now, let me pray with us as we come to the end of our service. Father, what do we say when we're confronted with a question as to whether we would be willing to suffer for the sake of our gospel, of your gospel? So many of us are caught in the trap of trying to live the safe and the comfortable life. We want convenience at any cost, and we will not pay a price for our faith. When we're stopped by the police, we're quick to bribe instead of standing for truth. When we have a legal case, we're prepared to do anything under the table so that we can get off, and will not stand by the truth. Forgive us, Father, where we have done this. We are hardly ever asked in this country to pay a price for our faith. And when the small breeze blows, we topple over, and we have not yet met the storm. Oh, Father, forgive us. Help us to know what it means to have died to self and been raised up in Christ. Help us to know what it means, like Paul says, to have the privilege of suffering the suffering of Christ. We pray for our brothers and sisters in India, and we ask that you would remember them and strengthen them. May that country be won over for Christ. The hundreds and millions of people who have never heard the gospel, may they come to hear. The many who are trapped in worship that is not worship, Father, would you throw the light on them, that they may see the risen God and know what true salvation is. India is a very religious country with much devotion to their many idols and their many gods, but they have not seen the light. Father, would you raise up an army, even including us, to pray for that country and to go and speak the gospel. Right here in Kenya, we have people who come from that country. Rarely do we ever go and share the good news of Christ with them, because we see them as closed off by tradition and their many gods. Give us a boldness to reach out in love and to tell them about the Lord Jesus Christ, that they may find truth and find life. This week, make us faithful to pray for the Indian church and our persecuted brothers and sisters. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you and have a great week.